Okay, I guess we're ready. Rich?
Go ahead.
Do you want to just go on? Maybe turn it over to
you,
Rich.
Go ahead.
We got the producers, you know, independent. Going on.
Independent Producers Organization.
Okay.
Live showcase.
All right.
All right. And there we are. Bruce Broussard over here. Teresa de Billis here. Richard Carpenter here. And we're waiting for Bruce to start us off.
All right, from the Oregon Voters Digest.
Right.
One of the producers, right?
Oregon Voters Digest.
That's right.
And
that's right.
On Sunday.
That's right. On Sundays from 4 to 5. Okay. 4 to 5 on Sundays. And that would be channeling.
Got to get that out.
There you go. Channel 11.
It's a hot time of year.
Very hot time of the year. I mean, in all due respect, we've got elections. We've got issues that are on the table.
Mm-hmm.
Very important issue from a national perspective and from a local perspective.
That's right.
And, Rich, I'll tell you what we're going to do tonight. And I'm glad that Teresa's here with us, too, tonight. We're going to be doing something on one from the state of Oregon. We're going to talk about the issues of the state of Oregon, some of the elections along that line. And we're going to talk about the national, because we got a presidential race. It's very, very important. And the reason why it's so important is that we're getting down to the point that November 8th is just right around the corner.
And people
are going to be voting, and they're going to be getting their voters' pamphlets. And what happens a lot of times is that people are really not understanding what the issues are until the last minute. And they don't spend enough time on the front end talking about the issues. So then they get in all this gamemanship and this, that, and the other, and people forget. And so the only thing that people get involved in the process, these folks who are running for office will be sending out all kinds of mailers and kissing the babies and all that good stuff and lying. This is the only time you have to be, only time you're immune, if you will, to lying. You know why that is? Think about it. Because the fact of the matter is that, let's say, just straight up with you, a person just takes out a big ad, right? That's what it's all about, the money. They take out a big ad. And then the person that's running, whether it be a male or female that's running against them, don't have the money. You know what I mean? So they say, well, look, that guy's lying. Oh, she's lying. And they'll run up to the media and say, look here, this person is lying. You want to take out an ad?
Mm.
So if you can't take out an ad, you can't counter.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying? So realistically, that's the problem that we have within our system right now, because that's what we need to do. So I think the focus should be on the issues. So realistically, shows like what we do are really the only opportunity that the layperson can get some understanding of what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
See, so when they get that ballot, they can say, this is what is going on. And I'll be right up front with you. And I think some of the tools that one can use without it costing them, I think, especially the voter and also the person who's running for office. Mm-hmm. If they file to run for office, they can pick up some of these same tools, because they'll be aware of what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
So they can lobby or talk to the people and knock on doors. Within the city of Portland, we've got mediums across the board. We've got Comcast. In fact, we've got the Oregon Voters Digest, we've got PCM, but guess what? You got to own a Comcast. You got to pay for it.
Right.
You got me? And that's important, but if you can't pay for it, then where do you go then? Well, you can then look at the newspapers. Well, a lot of these newspapers you have to pay for. The Oregonian you have to pay for.
And then
there's several other papers that you don't have to. A lot of times your little neighborhood newspapers you don't have to pay for, which is good, which you need to get. But there's some other ones that are just as, if let's put it this way, just as effective, maybe not from a statewide standpoint, but from a local standpoint, like the Portland Tribune, like we have today. I've got the Portland Tribune right here now. There's the Portland Tribune. And another one would be the Willamette Week. Willamette Week,
yeah.
And then, like I said, the local
Mercury.
Newspaper. The Mercury, you got the Mercury. Mm-hmm. And so now you have access to what some of the issues are. You got me? Now you can read the stuff. That's really the only accessible thing. And then the other things you have, if you can afford it,
right?
You can put this bad boy up there, right? You can get, and Google it. You know, if I want to know anything about Richard, I say Google.
Uh-huh.
Richard?
Okay.
Or Teresa, okay? So I just want to share with you about some of the tools that you need to look at.
That's right.
Because they're going to be staying in touch with this stuff all the time. So consequently, they're making comments and this, that, and the other. And that's if you have TV. You got the other mediums like CNN and Fox and MSNBC, and there's a number of, but the CNN and the Fox are the two ones, because you got the two major parties,
right,
between the Republican Party and the Democratic Party. CNN tend to represent the Democratic Party, and Fox tend to represent the Republican Party.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, you know, that's kind of like where it's at. Then every so often you'll get the, in all due respect, you'll get the lighter, the smaller groups, if you will, in all due respect, like the Libertarian Party,
mm-hmm,
like the Green Party,
yeah,
like the Constitutional Party. I mean, again, they're part of it, but they don't have that big money.
Mm.
And, you know, and so now you got these media folks that are doing this piece, and whether is it fair? No, not to a certain degree. But the bottom line is that those are the tools you have to work with. That's it. Mm-hmm. So now what we're going to do tonight, like I said, what we're going to do, we're going to try to, from our standpoint, because these are our own opinions based on our exposure to what we know, in the electorate, if you will, at this point in time. So we're going to share that with the viewing audience. And that's what we're going to do with you. But we would like for you to, if possible, get together with your neighbors. Get together with friends. Go to meetings. And when these people send you flyers, call them up, because I tell you, they will run to your door. If you're saying, I got 10 people at my house and we're talking about you, can you come over and chat with them?
Oh, okay.
They will be there. Trust me, because they want that vote. Okay? Mm-hmm. But ask them about the issues, not how beautiful they look and how they kiss the babies or how they hug you and this, that, and the other.
Right.
Ask them what the issues are. If you got problems with employment, or you got problems with crime, or you got problems with wages, you can just talk to them about it. They will respond. Then you check the media. Okay. Or you can Google them. Right?
All right.
You got me? So that kind of gives you sort of an input on that piece aspect of it in terms of how do you get to the issues. So what we'll do now, we're going to be basically covering some of the issues, and we're going to talk about it between the three of us here, you and Teresa. Oh, I might add, I got to make sure I bring Teresa involved in the process. She's here tonight because she's with Western Liberty Network, a very fine organization.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah, very fine organization, a nonprofit organization. And I had the opportunity to be working with them on, even from the Voters Digest standpoint, but they have opportunities for young people, anyone who wants to run for office. They've got classes to show you how to do it and what you need to do, and they had symposium. I mean, a very fantastic, and then they gave out scholarships and whatever, and it's a nonpartisan situation. Mm-hmm. Anybody can come, and it was a beautiful deal. And then they even put on a debate among some candidates across the board, and that was good stuff. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So I want to welcome her here, and I really appreciate the fact that she's here and want her to get involved. And I want you to know the fact that she is here, and that's available to you. And hopefully that'll be put on the screen. We'll put that Western Liberty Network on the screen.
Yeah, she needs to talk about
that. Yeah, let's put that on the screen. In fact, we might go on and let her have a few moments right now before we dig into this stuff, right? Is that okay? Okay, there she is, Teresa de Billis, Western Liberty Network. Okay, Teresa, why don't you spend a little bit more time telling the folks about what is Western Liberty Network?
All right, so Western Liberty Network is a nonprofit. The fancy way to say that, it's a 501c3. It is the educational arm of a political action committee. So we're nonpartisan, which means we're not going to help Republicans, we're not going to help Democrats, or only the Constitution Party, or only Libertarians, or the Green Party. We are here to help everyone get involved in politics. So,
okay. How do you go about doing that?
So Western Liberty Network, the easiest way to explain what we do is, I would say, so you don't like what you hear happening in politics, you don't like what you see, you don't like the options that you have available to you for voting.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot easier to complain about that than it is to get involved and do something to change it. So what we say is we will help you learn how to develop the skills to get involved in your local political situation to make changes. So very simply, again, if you don't like what you see, fantastic. Get involved and make
do
some changes.
Something.
Do something about it. So we have training. If you'd like, you can go to westernlibertynetwork.org.
Mm-hmm.
You can find us on the internet. We have many different free trainings that are available.
Awesome.
You just have to go to the bottom of the webpage, and you can click on different trainings. You can learn how to start a campaign yourself. You can learn how to run that campaign on little or no money at all.
Mm-hmm.
You can learn how to, if there's an issue that you find in politics that you care deeply about, you can learn how to maybe even start your own political action committee.
Mm-hmm.
And fight that issue that you feel so strongly about. We can show you how to write an effective letter to the editor. There's a specific way to do it. Editors at newspapers don't like you to make your letter very with a lot of words in it, but there's a specific format you can follow. You can state your situation and then tell them what you're talking about. And at the end of that, you tell them what you talked about. And then you sign your name on the bottom, and you include an organization that you're involved in. Most people have done something in their lives for their community, but they don't think about that a lot. But you can write that, yes, I've done this, so I'm a former veteran, or a member of the water district, or et cetera, et cetera.
Interesting.
So that's what we're here to help with, Western Liberty Network.
If you're not asking for money, that's sure different from some of the emails I've been getting. Everybody is asking for money, from Donald Trump, Hillary, all the way up and down.
But they never call you and first talk to you about issues. But if they are familiar with the issues, then that gets you to the table, so to speak.
Okay.
Then it can maybe justify why they might be. You might ask them, what's your budget? What are you going to do with the money? You know, what are you going to do? But like Teresa was saying, that their program basically goes through all of that. It just kind of educates you how to speak before an audience, all that kind of a deal. Because, you know, and it's a very important piece, too, because once you get in the election, once people file to run for office, you know, there are some folks that are in there that they have the money already. You know, they pretty well have a roadmap in terms of what they need to do. They've already contacted the major newspapers. You know what I mean? So because they're going to be interviewed, they know how to interview, they know what process it takes to get to be interviewed, that kind of a deal. And a lot of times what happens is that you see some of these debates that you might see around town, that's pretty well all fixed too. You know, in all due respect, you have to meet certain criteria. You gotta be up maybe the top three of the poll. I mean, I just went through an election, through a mayoral election, and there were 15 of us running. And as far as I was concerned, if they qualified to file to run for office, they should be treated the same across the board.
Yeah.
But what they do, they eliminate a certain number of folks. And as a result of that, the issue, then these people may have some real issues. And they have to. They have issues.
Mm-hmm.
And, but they can have, but the bottom line, we don't hear them. See, we don't put them in the debate. Mm-hmm. And so just the top three or top four gets the deal. And then depending upon, you could be actually you could be in the top four, but you could be sitting in the eight because you're not holding the poll. They got that. So my point is that with what they do there, and I'm really excited about Western Liberty Network, is that it just makes good sense. Again, it's a nonprofit, so they're trying to really teach and educate the person because it's so important. We need leadership today. We need leadership big, big time. And we're so sophisticated today. We're very progressive, if you will. And so my point is that most people don't want to serve.
Yeah.
Because of what they see out there, you know, from what we got.
Involves work.
Yes.
It involves being the one that does all the stuff.
Yes.
And then, sure, you have to make some phone calls and all that, but if you're involved in accepting all that work, it's one of the main things about being a leader, I think.
Well, it's a tough deal. That's what I say. You got to be aware of the issues.
Yeah.
And you've got at least you have to go in with one issue that at least you know.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That relates to what your job is. You're going to get many issues, and that's management. You got to get your right staff. You got to be able to articulate that stuff. You got to be healthy. You got all this other good stuff. You got to watch the conflicts of interest, if you will, because a lot of times people get elected because they buy the seat, and when they buy the seat, guess what? You have no access. You know, as far as
they've already paid for it.
Exactly, and you know,
they have a receipt.
And you know, a lot of times people don't realize that when people get elected, they figure they're kings and gods, and they, you know, they're the ones. No, they're not. It's the voter.
Mm-hmm.
You know, right. It's the electorate. Mm-hmm. It's the voter. You know, the employee is the people who gets elected. The employers are you.
Yeah.
You can pick up that phone and call them anytime you want to, but the bottom line, the way the system projects itself, is as if they won't answer you. If you're a Republican, are you a Democrat?
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? Right. You didn't vote for me. Well, that has nothing to do with it. You are my elected city council person or mayor,
right?
And you demand that. And if you don't, you give me a call, and we'll talk about it on the Oregon Voters Digest, and we'll expose these folks. Because in all due respect, I'm trying to make a little light of it, but the fact of the matter is we need strong leadership today. Most people don't want to run. I mean, they don't want you looking in their background and things of that nature. In fact, we may even start thinking about what's the definition of a human being now? There's no such thing as a perfect individual. That's what we're looking at.
Yeah.
We want a perfect individual to run for office. And that's a bunch of will. No. We need to define what it takes to run for office, mm-hmm. identify the issues, kind of like sign the contract, mm-hmm. so that if you do get elected, these are the things you're going to do while you're in office, right? Mm-hmm. You got okay. me?
Because you committed to them.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly. Very, very important piece. So now that we've done that, why don't we take an example here? I was thinking about, why do we go through Oregon first, and then, you know, and hopefully at some other point in time, maybe in the next show, we might do a piece on the national election, if you will. Mm-hmm. That's a very glitzy kind of one, big one, right?
Right.
But you got to have TV. You still have to have TV or the papers or whatever. But I was just thinking about, and by the way, I got the tool that I'm using the Portland Tribune, and I'm encouraging you to pick it up.
That's right.
Pick it up. Pick up your local newspapers, but pick up the Portland Tribune. Here's a good issue right here. That was on September the 13th, Tuesday, this
Already,
past Tuesday.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's out there in the racks right now. You can pick it up. This is a live show today.
Right.
We're sitting there. But the bottom line, you can pick up this issue. And it says that these are some of the issues right on the front page. It says, like I said, we're going to talk about the governor's race aspect of it. It says, poll shows Brown leading in the governor's race. And boy, that was a very interesting piece there. Bud Pierce is the Republican. He has 27% from the poll,
yeah.
And then Kate Brown has 44%
she's
of the poll.
Way ahead, isn't
very
she?
Interested, yeah. She's very. And then the treasurer's race is kind of interesting one too. Tobias Reed, he's a Democrat. He got 25%. Jeff Goodman has 18%. He's the Republican, and Chris Telfer is an independent, 9%. Undecided, 48%.
Wow.
Yeah, that's a lot to be undecided.
See, that tells you something, too.
I don't know anything about either
yeah.
of those two
yeah,
guys.
Yeah, see, and the same thing here. You know, when you think about the divide between Kate Brown and Bud Pierce, one is an incumbent.
Mm-hmm.
The other
that's
isn't.
Right.
That's the first thing. The first thing, mm-hmm. they're going to have majority right off the bat.
Yeah.
You got me? They have access to all the issues of the ones they've made.
Mm-hmm.
You got me? And some they hide some of the ones they don't want to talk about, and they keep the ones that they do.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times, in all due respect, in our state, we're kind of like a majority Democratic state, but from the majority metropolis.
Mm-hmm.
Outside of the Multnomah County area, we kind of like, well, you know, yeah, the fares itself out, but they're a little bit more conservative. So you can, and by the way, people say, well, Bruce, you got to be a conservative. No, you got conservative Democrats. Like you have liberal Republicans across the board. Remember, it's about you. You've got your vote, and you can only register for one.
Yeah.
You can't register for several. So, but the bottom line is that he got Kate Brown 44%, Bud Pierce 27%. And I think they vote neat people, by the bottom line, but it's about the issues.
This will be the first time that she'd been voted in.
Yes, yes, because she was former Secretary of State, right? She was former Secretary of State, and that was an interesting piece. We had John Kitzhopper. She basically picked up that seat,
right.
And they appointed her. And they didn't have the election then.
Mm-hmm.
They just appointed another D aspect of it. So she has to run on her own platform aspect of it. So she's got to accept what got Kitzhopper out, because, you know, he had his mate.
Yep.
Was having some issues and whatever, but the bottom line is that those problems were still there, and to a certain degree, between the auditor and the Secretary of State, they were very much involved in that whole piece.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yep.
So some questions need to be asked. Why didn't they do something then? Why didn't they do something then? You know, because it was. But the bottom line, that's politics. That's that old. I got mine, and you better go find yours. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I'm going to say whatever I can. But anyway, that's going to be a very, very interesting race. And in fact,
yeah,
it says the Secretary of State contest is a very tight race. Accordingly, see, Democratic candidate running statewide. Okay, Kate Brown, we got that. We did that. We did the Bud Pierce aspect of it.
Secretary of State.
Brad Avakian.
And Dennis Richardson.
Dennis Richardson? Okay,
yeah,
good. Talk
right.
about those two guys. You know what I'm saying? One was Labor Secretary. That was Brad Avakian. And Richardson, who had recently ran for governor.
Mm-hmm.
He's got good name familiarity.
2012.
You got 2012. You got to get to the issues.
Yeah.
It's the same old deal. You got to get to the issues. I might add that Richardson, you know, was a former military guy.
Mm-hmm.
A Vietnam vet. My guy. In fact, I've interviewed the guy.
Mm-hmm.
Very neat guy. Very family oriented, very structured, was very active while he was in the legislature. So he's got some good credentials. But again, you got that whole political piece that's fighting the situation or whatever, not dealing with the issues. And so I think one of the things they need to do is to make sure that they check out those issues that were sitting there when former Governor Kitsapa was there.
Yeah.
And go through how they're going to resolve those issues.
Mm-hmm.
And then, i.e., talk to some of the major issues. There are some major issues. You know, the economics, the economy is huge in this country. You've got wages, mm-hmm. huge and big and whatever. There's the whole issue of the environment. That's huge.
Yeah.
So that's a major issue. Any thoughts on that piece?
Oh,
as far
yeah.
as the governor, talk a little bit about it. How about the governor? Any concerns? Anything we can talk to share with the viewing party?
I'm not concerned. She has done an acceptable job.
Yeah, right. Okay.
That'd probably be because you don't see her headlines with doing all kinds of new things.
Right.
But she's just stabilized
mm-hmm.
the governorship
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and. It's she's been very interesting,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
We'll put it that way.
I might add, too, that on that same point, like you said, she's got to go through that now and resolve some of the issues that were there, you know what I mean, while Kitsapa, who was there,
yeah.
she got to go through, clean all that up, then put together her own platform
yeah.
to respond to the people.
But is that something the legal area have to take care of that or not?
Well, auditor was one. That was the treasurer's office, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, the state treasurer's. Yeah, she's sort of an auditor too. No, you got
the
secretary
auditor,
of state.
Yeah, there was an auditor and a treasurer.
Right. Auditor. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, you got a couple things, right?
Yeah. So, the thing that I've come to realize, I mean, you've brought up so many good points already. just you laid them out so clearly. That, I mean, you started the show talking about this serious issue. It's a serious issue that we rely on free publication that now, at this point, most of the people that I worked with for the last 8 years, and even before that, they can't afford CNN and Fox News,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay? They can't.
Yeah.
There's a divide, and the divide, as people you've probably heard talk about this, the divide is getting to be bigger and bigger and bigger.
Mm-hmm.
So your point is very well taken. It calls upon the citizen to be so much more proactive about how they're getting their information, mm-hmm. where it's coming from, always questioning the information that you're getting. Do your own research.
Mm-hmm.
I think that one of the common experiences that voters have, like you've said, unless you're being so proactive about how you're finding your information, you're going to find yourself opening up your voter's pamphlet statement and finding out about these issues for the first time.
Yep.
And voting based on what's showing up in the voter's pamphlet statement. So unless you have $750 to file a statement yourself and that you have a photo all ready to go,
mm-hmm.
You're not going to be seen or heard. And I don't know about you, but I tend not to vote for people that I can't see
mm-hmm.
visually in the statement and then read all that. Those are just some of the issues.
You want their picture in the voter's pamphlet.
Yeah,
you
I do.
But
that's really not where I want to be getting my information. That's mm-hmm. my last resort
yeah. mm-hmm.
as a voter.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm going to base my vote on those two statements there.
Mm-hmm.
I hope I'm not doing it that way, but I have done that in the past. So I've been involved actively in politics for about 12 years. I thought a lot about politics before I got involved. And my thoughts were, I don't like this system. This doesn't feel right. Okay? Why? Because you see things in your community happening that it doesn't smell right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? I mean, the river crossing debacle and all that, and you know, things like that. And as a citizen, I say to myself, well, I mean, even I wouldn't have made those kinds of conclusions. I wouldn't have done those things. And that's not good because I'm the least informed person about the whole
mm-hmm.
issue.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, as a citizen, you find yourself asking yourself these questions.
Mm-hmm.
You know what
why
I'm talking about.
$200
yeah.
million.
Yeah. I mean, why? This is your money. This is your taxpayer money. So anyway, long story short, I had these questions, and my natural reaction to politics was to feel, this is this is really ugly. This is not good. Mm. I don't like politics. Mm-hmm. So you tend to push it away from yourself because there's something wrong with the system. Mm-hmm. Well, finally, I got myself to the place where I wasn't pushing it away anymore. And I was saying, wait a minute. If I'm pushing it away, I'm not doing anything to right whatever needs to be righted. So that's when I started to get involved. Now, I am making a point here. Fast forward. You ask me right now about Kate Brown mm-hmm. and the incumbent, or the incumbent and her challenger. Mm-hmm. There are things that I found out about her just today that haven't hit the news. I'm not going to break the news right now.
Well, break it for us.
Well, I don't know that I can do mm-hmm. that. But I can. What I can say about it is that I've heard that she maybe didn't stand up to take some responsibility regarding some issues. It was
like
the lottery issues.
You
got to
give us the lottery.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. That's been in the news, by the way.
Okay. So that leads me to the conclusion. I say to myself, wow, how did she not do her due diligence there? Mm-hmm. Okay, I don't understand that. Okay, I don't see a really good reason why she didn't follow things through properly as they needed to be followed by the Oregon Constitution. Now you say that this is not new, anything new, but right there that bothers me. Mm-hmm. Okay, now I'm not for or against her. What I'm saying is that personally, I ran into this information. Okay, I also ran into some information about the Secretary of State. Okay, that office and how they dropped the ball on a certain issue about minority party and the dispute that's going on in the minority party, and that maybe the Secretary of State didn't do the job there well either. So my point that I'm taking a long time to make this point, is I had to get very involved in order to come to the place where I could make a decision about this person, mm-hmm. this person who's now our governor, okay? Now,
and could be
continue to be the governor, okay? Mm-hmm. I don't have to take anybody else's word for it. Mm-hmm. I went and I got involved and I listened carefully and I tried not to give way to biases that I was taught as a child. Oh, don't listen to the other side, they're bad. Mm-hmm. They're bad. They don't care about minorities, and they don't fight for the right thing. They're liars. You guys, it's not true. You don't have 50% of the nation that we live in mm-hmm. as a bunch of liars. It's just not true. So get over the bias. Mm-hmm. Get involved. Find out what you think is about mm-hmm. going on, and come to your own conclusions. Mm-hmm. Use your news sources, but think about your news sources. Mm-hmm. Don't just take it.
But like you said, when you start thinking about how do you access that medium, mm-hmm, what I mean? Mm-hmm. You can go all the way back to Lincoln. Well, if you ran for president doing that, just president in that time, you had to knock on doors. Mm-hmm. And then slowly but surely, it's not the doors anymore. You got me?
Yeah.
It's the money that you have.
Yeah.
It's about the money aspect of it. And then this night, let's say not too long ago, I think everybody recognizes that period, the rabbit ears, you had access.
Mm-hmm.
The masses had access. So the people on the other end who were controlling the situation said, look here, we got to make this thing difficult because it's not about a popular vote. It's an electoral vote.
Mm-hmm. The electoral college.
It's the electoral college aspect of it. And a lot of people don't understand what that means. We might want to spend a couple minutes on that piece.
We'll have to get Richard Burke for that.
Richard Burke. Well, I do know one thing, that it's not the popular vote that wins the election.
Right.
It's the electoral college.
Electoral college,
and the bottom line, in most cases, if you got the money, you can buy it. Because you can buy it through the legislature, because everybody has certain people have to vote, right?
Right.
They have a certain vote. Okay. But you'll find most of those people are pretty well conflicted in the whole piece. See? But the popular vote is a different ballgame. That's why I'm saying, like today, now here we are rushing. The majority of the population of this country are now being told people are running for office. Got me? So they're going for that majority. And so they really, and that's my feelings now, they're not really talking to the issues.
Oh,
yeah. They're talking about all these other things like your looks or your medical or your taxes and this, that, and the other. You say, well, wait a minute. What's that all about? It looks like we're jumping in that other. But as far as I'm concerned, it falls in the same category to a certain degree.
Yeah.
If you're going to talk about medical, about whether the person is fit or not. Well, okay. Well, then maybe when you file for office, that it put one of the requirements. You have to go to Dr. So and So committee, uh-huh. and you get checked out. Say, oh yeah, he's okay. Okay, fine. That's an okay. You can file. Or if not that, your taxes. The IRS already got that.
Yeah.
You say I want 10 years back, and you just pull it up. Uh-huh. See. So if you put that on the table to begin with, that means the individuals who are wanting to control will have to be very careful. They will vet the person beforehand too.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I think those are some of the things that we could do, but they're not being done that way.
Yeah.
They're just being discussed and going argument back and forth routine. But I want the people to know that that's the problem.
Yeah.
And we have to fix that.
Yeah. Okay. We could talk about that too a little bit.
Yeah, we need to fix that. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Okay. So that's part of the Oregon piece. So let's come down here locally. Something that I'm pretty well somewhat familiar with now because I just recently got off the campaign trail, still on, by the way,
uh-huh.
running for mayor. Aspect of it, but let's talk about the city of Portland and some of the issues that were there. I mean, the top of the list, as far as I'm concerned, is the homeless piece.
Yeah,
yeah.
And still sitting on the top of the list. And I can remember, and I was fighting it for days, that I had put Wapato. Let's just take the homeless, all of them, off the streets.
Hmm.
Put them in Wapato and process them. Sort of process them. Find out who's on the street. You'd be surprised. I knew. But no one else knew, and they still don't know.
Yeah.
And I tell you the rationale for that. Remember, all the service providers, it's all about the money.
Yeah.
You imagine how many service providers out there that are making money and got their shingles out saying, we do this for the homeless and this, that, and that.
Oh, yeah.
But the bottom line is, what do you do? And how many have you cleaned up, or what have you done this? How many housing and whatever? And then you ask yourself about the housing deal, the same thing with the housing for the homeless. Well, you got the Housing Bureau of the City of Portland. And you got a city commissioner that's sitting up there, one that's today, his name is Dan Salzman. I mean, he's sitting right there right now. And you know, here's a guy, he's in the business.
Mm.
I noticed in an article about 6 months ago that I think his gross net was 1 million plus.
Wow.
He's in the housing business. So you would think, here's a person sitting there, he's the housing authority, he's the lead person. I mean, he should already have those figures and facts
mm-hmm.
about we need so many housing, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he should provide them. But we don't get that. And then if you go and knock on the door, they say, huh, you can't get in here. So Bruce, you can't get in here. One, you're a registered Republican.
Oh.
Or if not that, you're not elected. And then I say, well, wait a minute here. Something's wrong here. I'm running for office. You know what I mean? And I might be elected. So should we not have orientation to give us a kind of an idea of what the bureaus are and what are the state of the city and this, that, and the other? But you don't get that.
Kind of like a presidential briefing.
Yeah, yeah, briefing.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
okay.
But the one who.
But for mayor.
Yeah, right. See, but the facts, though. I mean, get down to the meaty, nitty gritty.
Because okay.
This housing, this homeless thing right now is a major, major issue. And if you notice in the paper right now, it's not solved. People are coming to the table and say, well, we can build a high-rise apartment right there on the river for the homeless, right down the city, if you're in the city, if you will. Or we'll do it over here. We'll take they're fighting among themselves, if you will, but the homeless are still on the street. They don't even know that once they build the building, we might not have any homeless anymore.
Oh.
I mean, I'm just trying to figure out. And then some people are going out and the homeless in them and saying, I've seen this on TV and I know some of these people. In fact, one of the guys ran for mayor. You know, what's the guy's name right off the bat? Didn't come out. It'll come out in a minute. But anyway, he ran for mayor, and he said, "Well, I'm going to get me some tents and whatever, and I'm going to put it in my backyard."
Mm-hmm.
He broke the law. And there was this other lady who was saying, "Well, gee whiz, I felt so sorry. I'm going to put that trailer right here in my yard or my backyard or in this field over there." So you broke the law. And then on the other hand, I'm driving down in the city. They're all over the place.
Yeah.
They're just living on the streets and this, that, and the other. And you know, and when you think about downtown, it's kind of like I've said this once before with Pioneer Square, that it's like the living room. You know, it's like the living room of Portland, the living room of this state, because people come here visiting and whatever.
Yeah.
And we got the economy. It's impacting the economy.
Yeah.
People that work, people like to get off on Friday night and go somewhere and just sit down and take it easy or whatever.
Yeah.
And it's just a sad, sad note. Now, Wapato is sitting there at the tune of, they say, $500,000 a year just to maintain.
And it's empty.
I say it's $1 million. Mm-hmm. By the time you add up all the other little goodies and the perks and the time spent in paying that $500,000, it's more. It's about $1 million. How many years?
Yeah.
I'm gonna throw it out. Get a guess. How many years you think? How much money we've had? There's been enough time, much money spent on this thing to build two of those by now. Wow. Two or three.
Are you asking how much it cost? It was
no. How many years has that thing been vacant?
15? 6?
Well, Bernie Gusto was the sheriff at that point in time.
Oh my.
It goes back a ways, right?
Okay.
I'm gonna throw that out there. In fact, I'm gonna give them something to go out and do a little research. Go out and find out how many years this place been closed, and throw $1 million a year. And Bernie Gusto, I'm giving you a little info. Bernie Gusto was the sheriff at that time. We've gone through a number of sheriffs during that particular time.
Wow.
Now it's my understanding that Loretta Smith, one of the commissioners on Multnomah County, they own it now. At one point in time, the sheriff owned it. The sheriff owned, basically, they owned that property. Okay. And because of all of the so-called politics behind the sheriff that was just fired, it was made to down. Right. And a guy named Reese is going to be taking over the job now. Yeah. He was a former chief of Portland Police. Reese is a good guy. He's a neat guy. But the fact of the matter is that this county has it now, and they don't know what to do. And one of the commissioners got so frustrated, it's been in the paper.
Yeah.
And she said, look, we need to use that particular facility.
I don't know why they don't rent it out to other states that are crowded.
No, we need it. I'm just saying, they said we got to get rid of these homeless. They can't find any housing for homeless. No. Put the homeless in there. Even if it's just a mental illness, folks. And the county, that's the business they're in. I would have thought that once they got it, they would have automatically put mental illness in there. It's already sitting there.
Yeah.
But they're not.
Right.
So you ask the question, why? Mm-hmm. So you have to follow the money.
Yeah.
Always follow the money. But that's a serious situation right there. Now, so there she is. She's sitting up there trying to get this thing, trying to get the chairman, in all due respect, Kafori, who's a chairperson, Deborah, and neat lady, you know what I mean? But in all due respect, she should go on and say, okay, fine, we got this thing. Let's at least house them right now.
Yeah.
And it doesn't cost the taxpayers so much money. The taxpayers, we're paying this stuff.
Yeah.
And I know that Homer Williams, a neat developer, and this, that, and the other, but the fact of the matter is, he still has to build it. We're getting ready to go in the winter. It's going to be raining and this, that, and the other. So what are you going to do? You haven't rehabbed the property. You don't have anything yet. These poor people are going to be out there in the rain and this, that, and the other.
And especially when it gets cold.
When it gets cold and this, that, and the other. And now the people in the Gresham area, that trail that they had down there, they had to get rid of all those folks. They said they had 500 of them there. I think there was about 1,000. Some of them left before this, that, and the other. And they said they don't know where they're going to be gone. They put a few of them here, a few of them here, this, that, and the other. And in all due respect, law enforcement was frustrated. They don't know what to do. Imagine going up in there, you're having to step on needles in there and all kinds of stuff.
That's right.
I mean, it cost us hundreds of thousands of dollars just cleaning the place up.
That's right. Yeah. That's exactly
right. See what I'm saying? Yeah. So where's the leadership? Yeah. So where's the leadership?
I wanted to mention one thing. It's really bad news in here where it talked about more of them dying
on
the street.
That's the latest, yeah.
And that, of course, is a bummer.
It just came out, but guess what? That's been happening quite a bit. I saw that when I was out there knocking on the doors.
Yeah.
You'd be surprised if you saw the Bud Clark Commons right downtown over there by the railroad. Yeah. I walked in there. You should see those folks. Senior citizens, kids, people looked like they were dying already, trying to get that little boost for them from the heroin aspect of it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's awful.
Yeah. That's right.
But a lot of times people need to be aware that we need to solve that problem because it's costing us stress.
Yeah.
It's costing us a lot of stress, and a lot of our resources are going there
just to
band-aid the issue aspect of it. Yeah. So we got some very serious problems. That's one major area, see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And then the other deal is about police. We just keep going around and around and around and around with that deal. Mm-hmm. And people need to know we got to solve that problem because they are law enforcement officers.
Right.
Law enforcement.
Yeah, that's right, because the laws are there.
The laws are there. They're just the enforcement of it. And the people are the one that basically said, okay, fine, we're going to elect a mayor and city council. One of them will always identify themselves as the commissioner of police, and normally it's the mayor. It's their responsibility. Mm-hmm. See what I'm saying? Okay. And then the mayor then is responsible for, i.e., getting the policy and putting a training package with that policy. And then at the end of the day, then educate the people about, hey, here are the policies. These are policies, for, and then these guys are going to be enforcing these policies.
Right.
So they're not just policing, they're law enforcement officers. And we need to solve that problem because it brings up other deal. The whole race issue is involved in that whole piece of police. And we need to solve that problem. We can't afford that anymore. Yeah. We got to start talking about, what's that word I've always used?
Assimilate.
That was a new word that I got there. I've been using that quite a bit. But anyway, but the whole idea is that we just become all Americans. We can become Portlanders. You know, you work for a living, you go to work, and some of them getting $15 an hour, some $10 an hour, some getting $50 an hour, some getting $100 an hour. But, you know, everybody's got their own little piece.
And that's all they can do.
That's all you can do.
And
you're living.
Go to work and
pay your bills.
That's right.
Got to pay your bills.
Why it's hard for everybody to keep track of everything to do with all these politics.
That's right. That's right. That's right. That's right.
Need to work at it.
Yeah, and so we back. No, you're right, but we need to take the politics out of it.
We need to take the politics out of it. I was just thinking about that.
We need to take the politics out of it and deal with issues.
Well, one of the things I was thinking about too is how do you take the politics out of it? You need to go where you're going in order to do that. So you're talking so much about the influence of money. Mm-hmm. It's basically the negative influence of money. It's to the point, I heard you say this just a bit ago. You said, well, they bought their seat.
Yeah.
Now, what do you mean by that? What you mean by that is you can't run a credible campaign without a bankroll. You need a bank account with at least, I don't know how much money, thousands and thousands of dollars in order to run that. Then you have to have enough political influence to get other people to write you checks. Mm-hmm. When other people write you checks, are you beholden to them? Mm-hmm. You know, do they have a something they told you that they really care about, and after you get elected, you're going to take care of it? I mean, I think the thing is that when you take a look around and you see homeless people, right there, that tells you there's something in our system that doesn't work.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you're talking about money being at the core of that. It is. So
big
then
money.
The alternative is how do you take the politics out of politics?
Mm-hmm.
I'll tell you what one thing you can do.
Let's talk about that. Let's talk about solutions.
Yeah.
We'll go around the table.
Okay. Do you want me to say?
Yeah, you start.
Okay.
Start.
Okay.
What should we do?
What happens,
on the homeless piece.
What happens if the criterion for being elected to office changes, like you said? Right now, the focus is on the money aspect of it.
Mm-hmm.
How much money do you have? Mm-hmm. Where is your influence? Where are you beholden to that? So you change that. That's a whole nother subject. We can talk about that in a minute. But what if you take the focus off of away from you know, character assassination of your opponent? Okay, and you bring it back to the issues.
Mm-hmm.
You've talked about that. There's another way I'd like to bring up right now. What if you stop, you discuss the issues more, much more in depth, so that you don't talk negatively about your opponent, but rather you come to the table with a lot of solutions for problems that aren't so much about partisanship, because that's another red herring. That's another false issue that they want you to think about instead of the actual issues involved. But also, what happens if you take the focus away from the negativity in campaigning and you bring it down to something like, well, character? Okay, so I think I talked about this before. Character. What about are you a virtuous person?
Yeah.
What about it used to be called gallantry. Gallantry is gracious generosity. Are you a person who has something about you that we would call gracious generosity? What about the truth? How much do you stand up for the truth? Because you can stand up for it a little bit, you can ignore it the rest of the time, you can dedicate your life to the truth. Okay, that's a whole nother subject. What about service? Are you a servant of the people that will elect you? How much do you care about being a servant? Or are you a person that wants to jump out in front and take all the credit? Are you a person who isn't motivated by service and says, rather, I know the best way to do everything. I must know the best way to do everything because you elected me. Mm-hmm. So I don't need to listen to your opinion, mm-hmm. and I don't need to listen to your opinion. Okay? That's not, you're not being a good servant to the people. Okay? So we've covered some of them. There are more. But do you see how people aren't talking about those subjects?
They can't.
Right?
They can't.
Why can't you talk about it? Well, I have to come on your show because you allow this discussion.
Yeah.
And you're shaking your head yes, and you're saying it's okay to talk about this.
And I'm sharing with the rest of the folks too. They need to do the same thing.
Okay.
So indirectly, they're part of the show.
Okay.
You got me?
So what about courage? Are you courageous?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because maybe you're going to have to be courageous mm-hmm. to stand up to someone who you don't feel, or you know they're not standing up for truth. Mm-hmm. You're going to have to be courageous and challenge that.
Okay.
So you see, you can go down the list here, and I can mention more. I'll do it another time when I have it better prepared.
but you did good.
Do you understand?
I understand.
Okay, you pull the issue away from anything else that the media wants to talk about. See, they're about money too.
Oh yeah. It's always about the money.
That's the criterion by which we should be measuring our leaders.
I feel like I'm listening to Western Liberty right now.
There you go.
Western Liberty
Good
Network.
Deal. Good deal. Good deal. You got an idea? Give me an idea,
she
Rich.
She has a whole lot of ideas.
Yes. What do you think? To maybe get this thing to somewhat of a solution.
If you're asking me
what leadership
to think about the homeless,
yes,
that's not that easy.
Yeah.
Sometimes if you try to do something huge, like they're doing 100 million, aren't the taxpayers going to say, hey, wait a minute, you know, what about us? And so sometimes there's not a whole lot of things you can do, but where they found that those R2 or the Serenity Village, that isn't the right name, the one that's out there, that place took care of itself.
The Dignity Village.
Yeah, if they had another, it just takes a certain bunch of people to put that together.
Yeah.
Because these guys, with all the mental health and all the...
Oh, it's
and that one guy that just voluntarily, well, I'm here because I'm an addict.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Just admitting that.
Yeah. And where do you get your drugs? They give it to me for free.
Maybe.
To keep me on it. They're not doing anything to get me off of it.
Yeah.
They can't give me housing. I got a housing sitting over here at Wapato that's empty that the county is supposed to be responsible for that social piece.
Yeah.
They're not doing anything. See what I'm saying? And then they want to talk about it. I can't get them to come to the table here and just share it with the people, per se.
I bet you've asked them.
Oh, yes. We're asking them right now. In fact, I'd be more than glad to have them to come on over here and tell us, why aren't you opening up Wapato? I said it at the mayor's race, but I didn't have the money. But Willis said he didn't say anything. Ted's going to be the new governor. I was giving his.
When
he's
is going
to be the name. Well, I don't know either. Come to think about it.
Mayor.
The mayor.
Yeah.
In fact, in all due respect, I don't know either. Because in all due respect, I had problems with that. Because in Maine, you know, when you ran and one ran in Maine, whatever, then we went to the primary aspect of it. We had 15 people of it. And then all of a sudden, bang, he's still the secretary. He's still the treasurer secretary at the state.
Yeah, that's right.
So now he's got all this time.
Yeah.
And he's not identifying to the issue. The people think that he's the mayor. But we got two mayors now. We got Charlie Hill.
That's right.
Right? So realistically, as far as I'm concerned, once he won the primary, as far as I'm concerned, 2 months down the road, he should be in that seat.
Mm.
But then Cummins said that Charlie's out there trying to vacation. He's trying to say, I'm getting out of this stuff. I've been here. I mean, my hair's gray. I had homeless in my yards and stuff. And the people are pissed off at me. And I'm trying to be nice to them and react to the point. They say, oh, hell no, blah, blah, Charlie. And then there's Ted just sitting back looking at the scene. And then now he's getting ready to come. He has no idea what's going on. He has no plan.
Oh, I thought he would at least be in there measuring curtains.
Well, guess what? The other 14 of them that we ran, we knew what some of the problems were. As far as I'm concerned, he should have called a committee together, put together a committee, and let those people speak out. Talk about what can we do about the homeless. Then he'd have his plan. He could have just sat back and put the committee together and look at TV and get his staff, you know, to organize the response and have volunteers.
Yeah.
The 14 people that didn't win, they could have been volunteers. They're lost now.
Mm-hmm.
And there's some good folks. There were some good folks there. Maybe somewhat limited, just like all of us. We're all creatures of our exposure.
Yeah.
But at least they had the guts to put their name down and say, I'm running for office.
Mm-hmm.
That means they had some idea and something to put on the table. That's important.
Right.
Now, that, again, falls right in line with part of the solution as far as I'm concerned. I think when a person files for run for office, they should at least list down specifically, mm-hmm. give me three issues mm-hmm. that you are familiar with. You put it down, what the issue is, and a solution to that issue.
That's right. Yeah.
Put it down in writing mm-hmm. when you file.
Okay.
Now you gotta. By the way, give me permission to look at your tax return, because you gotta watch the money, your tax return from the last 10 years.
Yeah.
Gotta have it.
Okay.
Okay. And then the medical deal. Yeah, you gotta have a checkup, because we don't want you to die in an office. We don't want you. You know, we want you to be healthy, if you will, to a certain degree. You got me. And then you put that down there like that, and then sign it.
Okay.
You sign it. Now you got some sense of an idea of what the person's background is. And rather than wait for the voter's pamphlet at the last minute,
okay,
that is the voter's pamphlet right up the front. You got a photo of the person,
yeah.
The three major issues in regards to the city of Portland.
Yeah.
In fact, you can even list it. You can say, well, okay, we're talking about the economy, and we can talk about homeless. Maybe you can give them the three areas. Mm-hmm. And say, these are the areas that we want you to respond to. You see what I'm saying? So the people have some idea. So now you can get that. That's the first day that they file. That's recorded. Then the newspapers, they get it, and they print it.
Okay.
And they print it, and they go down there and start interviewing. The interview's already there. They start, because those are the ones that were doing the research
yeah.
on the person. Well, did you get it written up by you? Mm-hmm. Did you write it up, or did someone else write it up, or this, that, and the other? You know what I'm saying? Sure. So that, to me, makes a lot of sense. And then the other thing is that you got to have, if you're running for mayor, you got to have at least access to $50,000. You got to have something. You just can't go in there and just say, well, gee, I'm just me. Mm. No, you got to have some sense of response. Go out and refinance a house, or go to the family, pick up the money. I'm just trying to say, to a certain degree, you got to have some sense of separation, because otherwise you may have 100 people running for mayor, or 200 people. You can't restrict it to a certain degree, but just put enough in there, just enough, to just kind of get to the seriousness of it all, unless you have a special committee that will go through those filings and do that with the newspaper and aspect of it. But, I mean, but some way, shape, or form, you can't get the voter's pamphlet at the last minute. That's where I was coming from.
Okay.
That was one thing.
Speaking of that, that should be out later in this month, or do we know that?
Yeah, right, but November's just right around the corner.
Yeah.
Well, I know, yeah, but October comes first.
But but my point is the people are not going to be getting it. They're just barely getting it.
That's
most
right.
of the people who are getting it right now, if you can't afford Comcast,
yeah.
you don't have access. And that's, at what, 1%? Maybe 5% of the population, 10%?
Yeah, but again, that's national coverage.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah,
that's about 30
yeah.
million people or so, you know yeah. what I'm saying? You know, so
did you cover the things you wanted to prior to the end of this segment here?
Well, I think we pretty well, the point that I'm trying to make here now is that what you have to do is that on the Wapato thing. I mean, I'll give you the opportunity to get into it. You can call up Deborah Cafori down at the county. And ask her why, you know, and put some pressure. We call up Loretta Smith, because she's been in the paper and she's been supportive of opening up the Wapato. And they're holding back having the discussion on the commission. That should be discussed. That's another way of maybe putting it on the table, and then bring Ted Wheeler to the table. The Oregonians will basically say, well, look, what happened to Ted Wheeler? I just voted him in, but he ain't there. He's
yeah.
sitting at the treasurer. Why isn't he there? Why does he have to, this so long aspect of it? Huh?
If
who's responsible?
It's a good point. He won in May, right?
Yeah.
Okay, then all these other people, some of the other people are waiting until November for our local to win locally.
Yeah.
I wonder if everybody has to wait.
They shouldn't be. They shouldn't have to wait.
Okay, I agree.
They shouldn't have to wait. I think 2 months after the election is over, you got to be sitting in that seat because the incumbent is gone.
That would be fast.
Nobody's responsible. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Unless the ones that are just sitting there who didn't have any opposition or who won overwhelmingly, then they just sit back like fat cats because they're thinking about, well, I don't have to say anything until November anyway. That's another issue. You see
what I mean?
Because I really think that I really feel that the Housing Bureau of the City of Portland should be very much involved, and that's Dan Salzman. Salzman. He should be very much involved. Dan's a good guy.
Yeah.
And I think he can be more responsible, but it's our responsibility to do that. You got to call him up. Say, hey, you're the Housing Bureau. You're supposed to know about housing before it gets to the point that we're talking about right now.
Okay.
And if you can't do it, you got to move aside. That should have been brought up when somebody was running against it.
Yeah.
And then he would have responded, because he does know. He knows the solution. Because how could he have gotten to the position that he's in with the kind of money he's making?
Yeah.
So he knows the housing, the development piece, all this mm-hmm. development that's going on. You know, they could have called those guys back who they've given receipts and permits to build those jobs and say, hey, wait a minute, we got a housing problem here. I'll tell you what we're going to do. We told you to set aside 10% on this permit. We want another 10. That adds more. That adds more units to the table,
yeah.
And they're still building them, right?
Right.
So why not?
Okay.
See. Yeah. So I'm just saying, you just got to get involved. I mean, I just happen to be involved, and you just got to get more involved. So that's another area. So the housing.
Yeah.
The housing things can be resolved. Now, had I been given the opportunity to debate Mr. Wheeler and some of the other guys, but again, politics again. You know, OPB did the polling and.
Yeah.
I think I was number 2 or 3,
and
they held my name out. They held my name out, and they debated the whole deal for a while, and then they finally called me in, and I did 6 for a minute, but it's too late.
Okay,
you don't have the money, like Teresa was saying.
Yeah.
No money.
I want to thank Teresa for coming on, and we've got another, say, a minute and a half.
Right, okay.
And anything else you want to go over your website?
I did. So you're talking about what can we do? And you looked at the camera and you said, go call up Deborah Carfori. There are other things you can do. WesternLibertyNetwork.org. You can go to the website. WesternLibertyNetwork.org has some ideas for you, has some coaching. Write a letter to your editor. Get involved.
Good.
That's what Bruce Broussard just said. That's what you're saying.
Right.
You can't make any changes unless you get involved. There are things you can do. There are lists of people you can find to contact your leaders. Find out how to contact them. You can also contact the media. Okay. Yes. There are lists of names and numbers of your local media. You can ask them questions.
Okay.
They can lead you down certain pathways to find out more information.
Mm-hmm.
The point is you can, I think I heard you say, there's only so much you can do. I respectfully disagree with that a little bit. There's always something you can do. You are a citizen, you're alive, you can do something, but you can't do something if you give your power away and don't do anything
at all.
That's
your vote.
Okay, can you, go ahead and put up the playtimes there. Oh, that's great.
Oh, sounds
Thank
good. Sounds
you.
Good. Sounds
Thank
good.
You.
So there you go. You can check in, tell your folks and whatever. You know, we're here. We're really the people's voice. You know, wouldn't you say so, Richard?
Yeah.
Here at Cable?
That's right.
We are?
What we do.
That's what we do. And unfortunately, we're not listed, if you will, in the Oregonian.
Yeah.
And even the Tribune.
I'll
I mean,
say,
in fact, give them a call and say, hey, look, why don't you make sure you list the events and the time and whatever of these various shows. Just say, why aren't you carrying Portland Cable Medium, right? Wouldn't that be a good one? That would be a good deal. So it's a very, very, very important piece.
Well, I guess
And I guess the other, like I said, the other thing is that we've talked a little bit about Portland, but pick up the Tribune. Pick up the Tribune.
We're still on, Richard.
Yeah, we're still on. We got about another 2 minutes. Yeah, we got another 2 minutes.
We're out right now.
Yep, good.
2018.
Welcome again to the Producers Show live show, live showcase. Right on. I'm Bruce Broussard of the Oregon Voters Digest. I'm one of the producers here locally. And normally this with producers normally share their shows and their thoughts and whatever. And that's what I'm going to be doing tonight. And I happen to have one producer also with me. It's Richard Carpenter. There's Rich. How you doing?
By the way, tell us just a little bit more about your show.
Okay. My show, in all due respect, is it's kind of like an informational, educational format. That's the format that I have. I talk about politics, but I educate the average person, the person who doesn't have access to politics. I'm a nut for, if you will, for the news and politics. I've run for office on a number of occasions. And so I'm very familiar with the issues. So my job is to try to, my feelings and my passion is to educate the public. I want them to be involved because it's so important. It is so, so important that we have access to our surroundings because we're all creatures of our exposure. And when you're trying to pick up a leadership, if you only expose to say maybe a small segment of our society, it's problems. Because a lot of times it gives rise, if you will, to the kind of leadership we don't want, that we don't need. It's very, very important that we have leadership. That you got the passion, you have the love and love for people across the board. That kind of thing. So that's really what I'm all about. And I try to share that with the viewing audience as much as I possibly can.
Sure.
And by inviting folks like, you know, identifying folks like yourself and Richard, we have relationships. And then that's Teresa here, who's with the Western Liberty Network. And
right.
I'm very passionate about that piece because early on when I was trying to get involved in politics, I had no access to anything. Mm-hmm. I had no access. I had no money, but I had the passion to want to win, and I knew the issues.
Yeah. Well, did you come here?
Hmm? What?
Did you come here?
Well, I've been here for quite some time. Mm-hmm. That's why I'm here.
I know, but
I went down
did
with
you
Roger
do
Cable.
It as soon as you got interested in politics?
No. In fact, I was in the Marines. I was a Marine recruiter.
Oh, you
recruiter.
Got interested in politics.
And somebody got somebody got me because I was already out there on the streets, you know, trying to give young people an opportunity to get out of the area and make something of their life, you know what I'm saying?
Okay.
And I felt good about that. So then I got, as a result of that, I got into neighborhoods, talking to people, and this, that, and the other. So it's kind of a natural. Then somebody invited me on TV, a guy named Larry Dunham. I'll never forget this guy, of Roger Cable, when they first started.
Oh, yeah,
Roger Cable, way back when. And there I was, and he said, Bruce, you need to come on the show for about 30 minutes. And I said, oh, okay, I think I can hang. And then next thing, 30 minutes to an hour. And next thing you know, I was on Cable, and then I was on OPB. We did that at the same time.
Really?
OPB did the same time. Then I did a show on OPB. Mm-hmm. And then I did a show with KBOO radio. I was doing KBOO also too. And I've never changed the format.
Yeah.
It was all edgy. And I reached out to everybody, Democrats, Republicans, anybody who wanted to talk who had something to say.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And that's basically what it's all about.
So that's what you did then.
And that's what I'm doing now.
Opened up.
I just opened it up. I'm still doing the same thing, just trying to lay it on out. In fact, that's how I met Teresa and them. I mean, it was a vehicle that was out there. They contacted me, and the next thing I knew, here I am and there. And they gave up a scholarship, which made some sense. I had a young lady to go to the convention, and she went through the classes and she enjoyed them. She ran for office, you know, and she won in the one way. At least she was able to run and feel comfortable about running because she had some support.
Yep.
She didn't have all the money in town, but she did it.
Okay.
And she did well. And so now that's where I've got them now. I've hooked up with them to a certain degree. And hopefully now we can spread the word. And now when people are looking for debates or whatever and getting to know these legislation, hopefully that's going to be another organizational tool that they will possibly, I'm in it, they're entertaining it, the idea of trying to put those modules in their various neighborhoods, in their various areas. You know what I mean? We got four districts in the area. No, we don't have four right now, but we got five. But the idea is in each district, they should have a debate of some sort, where they know who the candidates are in the area and relates to the issues of that area. And so hopefully that works out. You know, hey, I'm achieving my goals. I'm feeling good. So that's where I'm at.
Okay.
So with that, so now what I'm going to do now is that I want to talk about the national politics. I've been really looking at the Comcast. I've been looking at CNN and Fox and MSNBC and the whole nine yards. I've been in and out of this thing, and the idea now is that I plan to share this with the viewing audience aspect of it. And and I just made some changes in my life, and I'll share this with you. It's okay. You know, we all have a vote. We all have a vote. We can only vote once, one vote.
Right.
And I'd been a listed Republican for years. I've been a listed Republican for years, but my passion there was to was to basically talk to assimilation. That was very key, basically getting people together, like going back to Lincoln's time. And I think I've always, and I felt very strong about this piece. I felt that if Lincoln had lived and not gotten shot, we wouldn't have this problem of race. Mm-hmm. I feel very strongly about that.
Oh.
But the bottom line is that it's not being taught in schools. It should be taught in schools.
That's right.
And then we get this divide thing among races and this, that, and the other. Hey, we all bleed the same red.
Mm-hmm.
All bleed the same red. You know, so we don't need to be divided, especially now. We're about 300 million people in this country, in these United States. There's a couple billion in the across the way there in China. A billion or something.
Then oh, yes, another over billion a billion.
Or so, there's another billion or so in what, another country that I...
India 1.2.
And here we are, 300 million. And then we're serving the whole world, if you will. We're providing everything. After the war, if you will, between Britain and we became a country, we took over that realm.
Yeah.
We're basically handing out checks every day. We're teaching the whole world. We're educating the whole world. But now that world, now they're educated because... they're going back to their respective areas, and guess what? They're major competitors.
Mm-hmm.
So now we got to change a little bit. So we can't afford the whole issue of race anymore. We can't afford it.
I would hope that'd be exactly right.
We just can't afford it. We can't just go out and buy a bunch of guns and sit at the house and say, "Well, I'll wait till Paul Revere rides up and say, the Britons ain't coming. You're already there. Your neighbor's right there." So we got to start cleaning up our act.
Yeah.
And get away from the whole issue of, like I said, the race thing is big, it's huge. We were fortunate. We just recently elected an African American, who happens to be of African American descent, but he's actually a black American because we have two different parties. One here is black and the other one is from Africa or whatever. But the fact of the matter is that we did. So we talked about race.
Mm-hmm.
We've been talking about race for the last 8 years, which is a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Which is a good thing. Now the thing is we're getting ready to transition again.
Mm-hmm.
Because now someone else is going to take the helm. You got me?
Okay.
And that's good.
All right.
That's good. Now we got to find out, make sure we get the right leadership to take it and take it to the next level. Okay? And that's where we are today. We got two senior citizens running for office. One in Donald Trump, who's 70 years old.
Mm.
And Hillary Clinton, who's 68.
Right.
You got me? And then we got, there's a possibility, we might possibly get a couple of people who are in, what do you call those elements, the other parties?
Oh, the minority parties?
Yeah, minority parties.
Yeah.
One in the Libertarian Party and one in the
Green
Party aspect of it.
Yeah.
And I think it's a good idea. We're getting ready to have the grand slam of the debates.
So are you suggesting that we don't just have two people to vote for?
Oh, that's right. I'm suggesting we need the engagement. You know, we went through the primaries, if you will, the primaries with reference to the everybody was there. The majority parties pretty well took over.
Yeah, that's really what
the Democrat.
That,
you
that's
think about
it in a nutshell.
That's
they
it.
Took
they,
over.
They took over the whole deal. Right. Now here we sit. We got two people from these respective parties, but we got these independent parties that are sitting out there. I think it's good. I mean, we've got the Libertarian Party. We got two governors, prior governors, who have run, and one who's running for president happened to have been the governor of Mexico. Well, that's right on the border, New Mexico.
Yeah.
It's right on the border.
Yeah.
So he should know something about the whole issue of this immigration issue, whatever. My point is that's a good piece.
Yeah.
And then we got the other one who's a senior one from the North, if you will. And then you got these two guys that are running, and I thought they would bring something to the table in terms of bringing up some issues. And then you've got a woman who's running in the Green Party.
Yeah.
And she's neat too. She's got
some pretty
good background, but she's, you know, she wasn't an elected official,
mm-hmm.
but she's a woman and she's very articulate. Very articulate. So I figured if those people were there together, then you got that, because now the way it is right now, you got media and you got New York. And if you don't know about New York, I know New York. New York is a whole different animal, okay?
That's right.
It's a whole different animal. So both of those individuals are from New York.
Yeah.
And where do you think the media is, the mass media? From New York. So unless you live and eat there, you don't understand New York. And so you got, and all due respect, you got one guy who's running, and all due respect, the Republican candidate, and realistically, he's not Republican, he's independent. He's really independent. He said that right up the front. The Republican Party is saying, well, he didn't beat us all out here, but they had nobody in New York. So there he is, Donald Trump.
Yeah.
He's a developer, but he's from New York. And he meets the criteria of New York.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
And so people are trying to figure out, well, now, he doesn't meet the deal. He's from New York. If you ask a New Yorker, they're all the same. I mean, I can lay it on out to you. And the same thing with Hillary. Now, remember, now the Clintons were at one time in Arkansas.
Mm-hmm.
He was governor of Arkansas.
Right.
And he got elected to president. And then he got into the Washington, D.C. climate. But all of a sudden, he got excited. Want to be president. So I moved to New York. So New York controlled the peace. That's our economy, in all due respect. That is our economy. That's the driving force. And all you have to do is just understand it. And then the idea is that's what we are. That's a very progressive kind of environment. If there was an assimilation in this country, it's in New York.
Mm.
Yeah.
It is totally assimilated. If you don't have no money, if you ain't got no job, you gonna leave or something.
Yeah.
So my thought now is that's why I laid that out on the front end to say, from a layman's standpoint, that's mm-hmm. just my experience. See what I'm saying? What I'm seeing, it justifies my statement.
Yeah.
Because when I look at the debates now, it's New York, and that's the way New Yorkers deal in politics in New York.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Hopefully it's still English back there, but this, my understanding is if everybody could talk their own language, there'd be 800 of them in New York.
800 what?
Languages.
Oh, no, there's not. That's what I'm saying. New York is English. It's not English as a second language in New York.
If they spoke their...
They have the languages now. Don't get me wrong. They have their pods. They have their communities.
That's what I meant.
But you speak English over there.
Oh, that's right.
Outside over here, we're kind of caught in a rock and a hard place, you know. It is English as a second language, you know what I mean? We got the immigration. We don't know how to deal with that immigration piece. You got me? And I'll be straight up with you. The farmers are pretty well controlled that piece. At one point in time, we had a solution. You know, it was a business type deal. The time for picking was there, and there was a business. Folks in Mexico would come in with a van of folks and let them pick the crop and get paid, and they go back.
Yeah.
You got me? It was fine. Then all of a sudden, people get greedy. But I'm just kind of going into it a little bit to kind of give my rationale as to what I'm seeing. This is my opinion and what I've seen. And I had the opportunity when I was at the Portland Observer. I used to own the Portland Observer newspaper. And I used to know the Mexican guy who was very much involved in the people business. He was very concerned about the Mexicans, their living conditions and their pay and things of that nature. And gee, was the name, but I should know the name right off the bat. I'm thinking about, it'll come. But the bottom line, that's what he was interested in. You see what I'm saying? But the other folks didn't want to pay them. And then after a while, they said, okay, fine, I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll just kind of raise the price of the goods we got out.
And that's what happens.
And that's what happened.
They passed, the entrepreneurs passed that on to you.
Pass it on to us.
I know we were going to talk about Measure 97.
Oh, yeah, we did, yeah.
Yeah.
That's another
thing. Sales
piece.
Tax.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, I don't.
We're sneaking in. Let's get back to the presidential race.
That's an Oregon thing.
That's an Oregon thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's talk about this, the presidential race aspect of it.
Okay.
And like I said, I can't give you a little feel of what I felt, what I was seeing after I saw this whole picture aspect of it. And again, she had asked me the questions about what about these two independent entities, you know, the Libertarian Party and the Green Party coming to the table. But guess who owns the committee that selects? There's a criteria. You have to have at least 15% of the population.
Yeah.
You got me? And so guess who's fighting to prevent that? So you don't get the 15%. They say, no, we don't need that. Because in all due respect, we got New York. New Yorkers say, hey, we're controlling this, baby. Yeah. You know, we're going to run it the way we are. The issues are not in New York. The issues are outside of New York. That's the problem.
So what kind of a democracy is that when you're stifling voices?
Well, but the bottom line is that was the economy. That was the, because we're a capitalistic society.
Yeah.
I mean, that was the home, that's where it was all created, and that's where it's being monitored.
Mm-hmm.
And don't get me wrong, that's who we are.
Yeah.
And so I'm saying, at the end of the day, we're going to be fine. Now, that's just me. I mean, that's just me. And then these independent parties are going to grow. And you might not see a bigger R or a bigger D. You're going to see a bigger independent that are sitting over here on this end of it. These people, you got Bernie Sanders, you know, all of a sudden. And when has ever a socialist has just gotten to the point where he was.
Yeah.
And in fact, in all due respect, had he stayed in, Hillary wouldn't have been there. Mm. I mean, that's my feeling, because he had the momentum.
I think he let a lot of people down when he backed out and gave his support to her.
New York.
Yeah.
It's about the money.
He was really touching people
and
changing lives. And then the next thing you know, he's thrown in the towel.
But that's my point.
Yeah.
The point is that it's New York.
I'm agreeing with you.
You see what I'm saying? Hillary didn't move to Arkansas. They didn't go back to Arkansas when Bill was out after he did his 8 years.
Stayed there, yeah.
They went to New York.
Yeah.
See? That's where they are.
That's right. And there's nothing wrong with that. I'm just saying that's the way our system is.
Mm. Yeah.
I'm not saying, and then she's a hard fighter, you know. She's tough.
Sure is.
But you know, after I heard some of the things that Colin Powell said today, you know, they've been hacking his emails and whatever, and Colin Powell came out, and all due respect, rightfully so, the Republicans could have been the lead today as far as the presidency had they given Colin Powell the opportunity to run for president.
Yeah.
They could have had,
really?
If you will, the minority president. Colin was more articulate than any elected official in the country.
Okay.
The man had gone to each major entities. You know, he was Secretary of State. I mean, he's the main guy. He was Chief of Staff. I mean, he ran the entire military aspect of it.
Yeah.
I mean, the guy was very articulate.
Yeah.
But they didn't want him to run. The powers to be at that point in time.
Yeah.
So then here comes another group that brought in Obama.
Yeah.
Obama had not been in the military. And think about it. Now, when you start out the military, that's quite a base to start off with.
That's right.
He had his base. He was very articulate, very sharp. But people were saying, well, you know, he's not Republican enough. They said the same thing to me, and I picked up the Libertarian Party. And I took my Lincoln with me.
Mm-hmm.
But my point is that that's the way we live. You know, so my point is, I feel very comfortable about the fact I got one vote. But I got the freedom of speech. I got I got those amendments that are sitting there.
Okay.
And I understand them. Yeah. I understand that little book that everybody talks about. Have you read the book? I read the book many times. Yeah. And I feel very comfortable. And I paid my dues for this country.
Okay.
And I mean that. This is my country, too. Mm. I still remember that My Tears of Thee. Remember that one?
Mm-hmm.
So the bottom line is that, getting back to our deal here, we got Donald Trump. And here we're running. Now let me get down into the meat of the matter aspect of it. Okay? The thing everybody wants to hear now, right now, we'll just kind of play the game. You think about it. Here's the media. You got both media, the major media from New York. Their whole focus now is on the medical thing and the taxes and the emails.
Well, that's
isn't that something?
Yeah.
But you know what I would do to quell that overnight? But you know, you remember now, from a historical standpoint, that has never been implemented for the president's presidency.
Yeah, that's right.
Why? Huh. New York is about the money. I mean, there's no one that can reach 70 years old or 78 years old that hadn't done something.
Yeah.
There's no one can reach 70 years old and 69 or 70 and 78. That's where I'm at. Rich, what do you remember? You about what? About 70, 72?
Yeah.
See about 72? But the fact of the matter is, they start looking at our background. I just had a little recent little bump in my heart there for a minute. I mean, if all of a sudden somebody say, well, Bruce, are you going to, Bruce can't run again. I can run. I will run. I'm going to run again. You, same boat, right? I mean, you know,
we'll vote for you.
We all get older.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, you're not the same individual. We don't have no perfect bionic kind of a person running around here. Bottom line, it's about the issues. What do you know about the issues? Can you articulate the issue? You have staff and all this, that, and the other. You got represented, all this other good stuff. So, hey, there's nothing wrong with that. But if you want to change it, just say, okay, fine. If you're going to run for president, you got to come up with 10 years of your tax return. And you got to go over here to this group of doctors, and they'll give you a physical.
Mm-hmm.
Just to make sure you're at least 60% healthy. Not 100. You'll never reach 100%. Not these two people. I can't reach no. I mean, but Marine Corps helped me out quite a bit because I'm physically fit, but guess what? I had a little burp. Now I'm carrying a pacemaker, of all things. Got me? But
yep.
I'm still here, kicking.
That's right.
Yeah, I'll be right here at the table, too. I'm not moving.
Thank God you're still here. We need you.
So this is where they, but again, I'm talking about this piece because that's the news today. They're talking about the emails and the hacking. Now, Colin Powell got hacked. And then
they all get hacked.
You got all hacked. Everybody gets hacked if you got money. If you don't have nothing, you won't get hacked. You're wishing to get hacked.
But then how do they get money if they hack into somebody? Well, if they're identity thieves, then they get money.
No, but you're messing with the money. See, you're messing with the money, see? Because you hack somebody, so you say, hey, what you're messing with my money, so let's make a deal. I won't hack you if you leave my hack on. You know what I'm saying? So it's okay. We're in the net world. You know, it's called right here. Here's the hacker right here. Isn't this the hack?
Sure.
This is the hack right here. This little machine right here.
Okay.
You can hack anybody. All you do is just hit something, and if you hit the right numbers, you'll get somebody.
That's right.
That's why I don't use it anymore. I do the YouTube piece. But anyway, that's what they're talking about. But my point is that you got the media. The media is not owned in New York by the little people. So they're focusing on the issues of what's going on. And I brought up something in regards to I'll give you an idea. The Trump is more senior than Hillary in New York. She moved there. He was born and raised there.
Oh, yeah.
He knows everybody. He knows Al Sharpton. He knows them all. Al is New York. See, now I'll give you some little tidbits. For instance, first thing with Hillary, I started saying, well, where's Al Sharpton? I mean, he's Reverend Al Sharpton.
Yeah.
This guy, he's a powerful dude.
Yeah.
And the ministry, the black church in our country is powerful piece. Mm-hmm. And he's sitting right at the front of the table. And when I see these others, so when I see Hillary doing is reacting to what Trump says. She's always on the defensive. He's always on the offensive. Big time. Yeah. He just sits back and wait. And he just went out and got a number of black ministers and black folks, and you know, he got together with them. But then I didn't see her call Al Sharpton, who's a Democrat. In fact, he wasn't even part of the campaign. I mean, the convention. Mm. Al was not one of the speakers at the convention.
Mm. Yeah, that's right.
Jesse Jackson wasn't a speaker at the convention.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
So you ask yourself, and this guy, like I said, Sharpton is from New York. Mm-hmm. He knows the game. See, but he's out of the deal. See, and he's got the National Action Network. You got a network, but I'm pointing, it's a national deal, big time. Like I know the president here in Portland.
Why do you think that happened?
Well, because what do you mean, with regards to?
When Al Sharpton wasn't part of it.
Well, again, politics. if she knew New York, she would have had him in there.
Okay.
You got me?
Okay.
Maybe a deal was made. Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to, I want to go that deal. But Trump was just loving it. Yeah. He's just sitting back. Now, if Al had been there, it'd be a different ballgame. He would have sat down and chatted with Al. He already knew Al. Mm-hmm. They'd worked together on other different issues and this, that, and the other from New York.
Yeah.
See, so that was a thing. The other thing is that now, the other thing I'm talking about is that, like I said, with reference to, I already talked about Colin Powell, right? Mm-hmm. Colin Powell was a Republican, right?
Yes.
And then, you know, all of a sudden they were saying, well, Colin is this. Well, they hacked him. First, the media came out from the standpoint that Colin was the one that brought the issue up about, you know, she was this and he didn't tell her this. And this. No, that wasn't the fact.
Yeah.
He got hacked.
Yeah.
And so one media, i.e. Fox, put that piece on the table. See?
Okay.
I looked up something. You're going to like this one. You're Donald Trump, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know what definition of a Trump is?
Yeah. It's a Trump card.
There you go. any playing card of a suit ranked higher than any other suit for a given hand.
He's the Trump card.
Any advantage held in reserve. Mm-hmm. He got the Trump card.
Mm-hmm.
He hadn't even thrown the Trump card out yet.
Yeah.
That's right.
You know, and I'm predicting right now, I'll be straight up, and then we'll go into the conversation.
Okay.
He's going to win.
Yeah.
I'm predicting it right now.
Yeah. Okay.
He's going to win. And don't get me wrong, it's not a loss, because with all of this big push on who's going to be the president, that's a tough job.
Mm-hmm.
He is going to be a good, calm leader. Everybody thinks he's all got all these radical thoughts. He isn't. He's everything under control.
No, he's going to have to.
and he's going to do it just fine.
Because the media's there. They're putting it all out there. They're basically working on the platform, the things he has to do.
Right.
Because that wall that we're talking about, that's not going to be no physical wall. The wall may be in the form of quote, jobs and bringing some of that business back here, you got me? That job may be in the form of, well, okay, fine, we're gonna audit the services that we are providing at no cost, and we're gonna send the bill back to Mexico. Mm-hmm. Say, hey, this is your bill for this month. And by the way, you can send us a bill too, comparable. Mm-hmm. And we got folks going over in your country that's not is doing this, this, that, and the other. We'll send you a bill. And then they'll go down to the United Nations and do the same thing for all the countries. If people start going from one point to the other, then guess what? Here's your bill.
Yeah.
You got to pay. So that, to me, is my definition of what the wall is going to look like. There's no, you can't do, because there's no such thing. You got airplanes nowadays. You got machines that can dig underneath the, they could be probably digging underneath our deal right now. Oh. You get tunnels and all that. So my point is that I don't see no wall. But I felt comfortable about the fact that I was a developer too at one point in time. And it's tough to develop when you get into, it's just a small few people that can pick up some permits.
Yeah.
So you got to either be in the inside, it's going to cost you some money to get the inside.
Yeah.
But it does create jobs, but you can lose too.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, I've built a couple of senior citizen projects, well, one in particular, but I rehabbed a lot of houses and this, that, and the other. But, you know, I lost money too.
Yeah.
I wish they would have given me the opportunity to go on and stay in the rehab business, because I would have had housing. I mean, Northeast Portland would not have been the way it looks today. Look at it today. Gosh, it was at one point in time, houses were going for $7,000 and $8,000.
Gosh.
Oh, yeah.
You okay?
Oh, I know.
So, but the bottom line is that some folks just, they just let it stay that way, and they call it race, so people wouldn't go in the area because the blacks live over there.
Oh, yeah.
But then the people who stayed,
they're kicking
the money. Yeah. See, so things are evolved, because for every loss, there's a gain. For every gain, there's a loss. Mm. So to me, as far as I'm concerned, it's not the issue of where he got his money. I'm interested in what his background was in many ways.
Yeah.
There's only two major people running. I'm looking at both endings. See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I'm looking at one that wasn't the developer, and then seeing one that was. Then I saw one that's in the so-called politics of it all. That's where Hillary is coming from.
Yeah.
He was in politics, but outside of it.
Yeah. Yeah. See, well, you get that feeling from him, too. I want to make a comment about it.
Yeah, going on.
So this is just coming from an aspect that most people aren't going to think about. But I want to make the point that, you know, I really hear what you're saying about he made himself. He was a developer. He's a businessman.
Well, his dad was first.
You see him getting into, let's say, the presidency and actually making changes, political, economic changes, because he's a business person.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, whether you like him or not, we need some healing in the area of economics and business. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's the entrepreneurial spirit. Is you know, you pull yourself up by your bootstraps and you get going. But here's something that's interesting about Trump. I want to make this point. You know, people can get really jealous of people with a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
But I, you might not know this that's about natural. Donald Trump. We all have basically the same gifts. We're human. Everybody has the same gifts that they use to basically create their reality. What is different about Donald Trump, he has the exact same amount. Okay, you create your reality with your thoughts and your decisions, your choices, your feelings, your beliefs,
mm-hmm.
your attitudes. Mm-hmm. Okay, all of those things come together and boom, you're making your life. Okay. Mm-hmm. He applies all of those tools with more focus than anybody else,
mm-hmm.
basically. So what I want to tell the average person,
mm-hmm.
you were born with the same amount of skills that he has. He just wakes up in the morning and he says, he has a great attitude. He says, I can do this.
Yeah.
I can own the biggest building in, you know, in this area. This is fantastic. You listen to the language he uses.
Yeah.
He focuses and he hones his thoughts and his feelings and his decisions and his beliefs, his attitudes, all of that more sharply and with a much higher degree of focus than most everybody else. He makes a lot of things happen in his world. The point again, everybody has the same amount of tools. You put your mind to being a developer, you are a developer. You put your mind to focusing on politics, you've done a magnificent job.
And it's not just about the money. That's what I'm saying.
No, it's not.
You can have the same attitude he has, making $20 an hour.
Right.
Understand what I'm saying? I got a place to live. In fact, in many ways, he won't have the luxury, if you will, of the activities that he's normally accustomed to being sitting in that White House. He can't walk down the street and get a bucket of chicken like I saw him in the plane today. he likes that fast food. He can't walk down there anymore. Obama can't walk down there anymore.
Who was that who used to do it? It was Clinton who used to do that.
Oh, yeah.
He would duck away into good McDonald's.
Oh, yeah. In fact, he was so excited, he moved to Harlem when he first got out. He moved in Harlem. He was eating them neck bones and up there with Al Sharpton and all those guys and whatever, and just having a ball. Then he got that heart attack, see? He can't hit that area.
I wanted to go on a little bit further in a different way about what you're talking about. Everybody has been saying, well, we have all these politicians that are in office now. They've never worked a day in their life, and they've never done anything. I don't know why we keep voting them in. People are always saying stuff like that. And so along comes Trump. Here's somebody that's worked hard all his life, no matter what. And whether failures or not, he has worked hard. And he is the guy that should go in. And finally, we got someone that hasn't just been sitting around being a politician all their life.
Well, you know, in all due respect, again, we are living in a time where some words are very sensitive. Mm-hmm. You know, we're living in a time where things are very sensitive. We got the race thing that we're still dealing with. And so, naturally, you've got, depending upon one's exposure. I mean, I was exposed in the Marine Corps. Mm. I went all over the world. You know what I mean? So I was exposed to a lot of stuff. And I can still say that I was exposed when I first went to boot camp. I mean, I was kind of like one of two guys, and I was in there. But the thing is, I had ROTC background coming from Texas. You know, I was in a semi-military type deal, ROTC, but I knew my left from my right and whatever. So my focus was basically being the best. And I ended up the leadership of my whole platoon.
See how you focused?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
You said you focused on being the best. You focused on success.
And when I tell you my leader said to me, it was very interesting when the whole issue of race came up. Mm. Very interesting. Mm-hmm. I'll tell you the story if you want to. I might share this with anybody.
I hope you do.
But the bottom line is that we had pugo sticks. You know what I'm saying? So you get upset, and bang, they put you in the ring, and you know you have the pugo stick aspect. Well, I was a guy, my drill sergeant, the drill leader. And so sometimes I'm running up there, and if he put me in the front of the deal, and there I was the platoon leader, and we'd march up the hill, and he said, "Let's go." And I'd go up front and I'd knock some folks down on the side and shoot up, that kind of deal. But when race came up to me, it was just, I discovered from him, who was a white guy, big time, but he was a Marine, mm-hmm. hard-nosed staff sergeant, hard-nosed. Mm-hmm. He accept no excuses for nothing. Mm-hmm. You go. And they would compete within the company. Yeah. We had four platoons and whatever, and I can still platoon 212. I'll never forget that 212 platoon. And so what he would do is that when we'd go through the obstacle course, between the platoon sergeant, they would compete with one another. Mm-hmm. He said, "I got mine. I bet you mine could beat this guy over here. I bet this man can beat this guy over here." He said, "I bet you mine won't be the last one. You guys can all go through. And he won't be the last one." And he'd hold me back, and I'd come through, and I'd be number two. I'd run anybody and I'd do whatever I had to do, but I was focused.
Yeah.
I could care less. You drop me anywhere and I'll take care of it.
Wow.
But my point is that's where I got my focus.
Yeah.
And then when I went out and I spent the time in the Corps, and I felt good about that. It just made me someone that I could take care of myself. I was independent. I had a good independent mind. I wasn't a racist. I mean, but they taught you how to accept the fact that you're an American,
mm-hmm.
and feel good about it, feel proud about it, don't step back on anyone or this, that, and the other. And it was cool. And even when I got out of boot camp, there were some folks that were living deep down south who I know their folks were, in all due respect, were wearing the sheet.
Yeah.
But I can go in that bar and have a drink and with my uniform on, and they'd say, "Sergeant," even when I came to Oregon, I had problems here to a certain degree. But I'd go down to Eastern and Southern Oregon and this, that, and the other, and those bars, and say, "Your money's no good here. Just come over here and get that drink, Gunny." Mm-hmm.
Mm. Wow. So
uniform.
So through adversity you focused like a laser beam and you reached inside and found your power so that you became almost comfortable, and it didn't matter where you went. You could go anywhere and you had that deep sense of confidence because you weren't afraid. You see, there's so much in that story. It's very powerful. Now, I can see, because I know you at this age, you just told everybody how old
you are. Still focused.
You're still focused, but also you're not afraid.
No.
And you have a tremendous amount of confidence, and I can see that it stuck with you your whole life. So it took adversity to get you to the place where you taught yourself that.
Yeah.
You found your power.
And I think we're there. We're there. That's what I'm saying. I still feel that we're there. I'm still, again, like I said, education is very, very important.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I've always maintained that when I say public education, see, public education to me means that you get the finest, the best education you can get. I mean, up to a certain point.
Mm-hmm.
You get me? Then you're on your own.
Yeah.
That's my mindset. It's like saying taking the community colleges, we pay for that anyway. Today's date, as far as I'm concerned today, a person should graduate from the education during those formative years with an associate degree. Yeah. Automatic. And they can put it into the K-12. Now it's K-12, but you got two years of college. Then after that, you're on your own.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to go to a college, guess what? You pick up the tab. You go out and work and do whatever's necessary and pick it up, because you can't have more chiefs than Indians anyway.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? Because right now it's ridiculous. I mean, people today they graduate from high school, and to continue and graduate from high school, they go to community college. And they spend they spend about maybe 6 months, sometimes a year, and they drop out.
And
in today's society, if you don't have a job, you got a problem. The only other alternative you have, a lot of our young men especially, are going to the institution, criminal justice. And once you get into that situation, then that's another economic arm where people are making money from.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? But we want to be in the productivity. So that's another thing I see that possibly that Trump might be able to relate to. He's kind of like touched on it. I've seen that, because he's a developer. He's a developer.
Mm-hmm.
He's got to get a project done, because I've gone through that process. And then sometimes you get benefits if you can complete the project earlier, mm-hmm. all that kind of stuff. And you know, because if you lose some stuff or lose material or this or break down, you can lose everything you got.
Mm-hmm.
But he has, what I've seen is that his dad was the one that brought him up to this thing, because his dad was in the housing.
Mm-hmm.
He was in low-income housing stuff. You know what I mean?
Right.
Kind of ghetto, loud, poor folks. That's how he made his money. In fact, the other mayor of New York, he was about ready to run for president. He was in the same thing, in sub-housing, so to speak. Yeah. But my point is that he had that relationship. So he said to his dad, I want to go downtown. I want to buy me a hotel downtown.
Yeah.
And I still remember the story that he basically bought a small lot and sold squares for the price, sold squares of that real estate.
Yeah.
I still remember that. I was wanting to buy one, but he sold squares right downtown.
Wow.
And then he knew how to deal with the bankers and this, that, and the other. And the bankers try to make some money. He got to make some profit. So he was he was focused. He just said, hey, look, I can do it. Give me the money.
Uh-huh.
Say, no, you can't. But you read I'm just saying, I'm reading it because I've been exposed to some of that stuff. And I'm not suggesting that the people out there are like me, but you've got just as much as a gift as I had.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And we're all creatures. I've said it before. We're all creatures of our exposure. And every exposure to me has assets. There's no such thing as lesser than anybody else. We're all equal.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that you have to just identify your focus. If you want to do this, you want. And in some cases, if you identify it higher than, you may not get to the top, but you get so close that you will achieve.
That's right.
You know, that's what I say. Just like when I run for office, people say, "Well, gee whiz, you lost." No, I did not lose.
Mm.
In this case, I won by losing. At least I got my issues on the table.
That's right.
When I ran for mayor, I spent $750
and you got
of my money.
Yeah.
Oh, yep, right.
Some guy over here spent $200,000+.
Yeah.
And $50,000, all this other stuff. And they had to have all that pressing. When I had to walk the streets and this, that, and the other, I'm sitting over here on the deal and wanting to interview these folks. They don't want to interview. And And I know why. They don't understand. They've not had my exposure. But that's okay. Mm-hmm. So I'm getting back to Trump here. Well, we got the Trump deal, right? Let's get back to the playing card. We understand what that's all about?
Yeah.
Okay? But now Clinton, on the other hand, you know, she to me reminds me of Golda Meir.
Oh.
Really?
Prime Minister of Israel.
Israel, yeah.
Yeah.
Tough woman, the Iron Lady. That woman, Colin Powell made the statement. He told her, said, look, you're working too hard. But she's focused.
She has been working too hard.
She's working too hard. But the bottom line, she's a good person. But sometimes you get to that point, you start making promises you can't keep.
To yourself.
Yeah, you can't keep.
That's
you
right.
Say, but you got to watch what you say sometimes. You know what I'm saying? Like just saying, well, I'm gonna say anything you want me to say in some cases. She really doesn't mean that. But she really is, as far as I'm concerned, she's just as equal. And she's a woman, you know what I mean? I mean, a woman had a tough time coming up during the old age, you know, the voting rights act, way back when, that kind of a deal. But the bottom line is she has some assets. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, Bill.
Poor Bill. Bill's going back down to Salem. I mean, the Harlem down there. He likes Harlem. He's a good guy. You know what I mean? But it's she's focused to the presidency aspect of it. Mm-hmm. So I still say that those two. They got assets, but the media's got to deal with the issues.
Yeah.
So it's as if to say, whoever gets to that debate's going to be the determination as to how close the race is going to be.
Yeah.
But right now, and I'm not just saying because of the poll piece, I'm looking at the two candidates, and Trump is the guy for the progressive aspect of it.
Mm-hmm. And
she's been in that other system because it's already been said that the majority of the public do not like the Congress. They do not like D.C.
Mm-hmm.
That's always been said lately, right? And she comes from there and right up front with the people or not. But she's got enough money to maybe go this way and this, that. But she can't deal with that press like Trump because he's from New York. And it's what's that show that he had? It's always
The Apprentice.
The Apprentice. See, he knows how to handle the press. He may not know these issues, so guess what? He just deal on this other stuff over here on this end. He just sits back and relax. Colin just made the statement, so he jumped on that. Then she kind of trips up a little bit. She's older. She should faint sometimes. She's a human being. She gets sick, and so she faints a little bit. And then he said, oh, well, it's hot here. It's really hot, about 120 degrees. Got all you folks here. I wonder, could she handle it over here? So he hits it that way, so the press runs that way.
Yeah. Well, he knows how to handle the press because anything he says, everybody else has a feeding frenzy on it.
Yeah.
He doesn't care. He's on to the next thing.
Yeah. Then the other thing I was going to say, the email, you know, hack, you know, mm-hmm. got a new word, hack, right?
Yeah.
Remember the word deep throat?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Same concept, right?
Yeah.
Remember those guys got in? Deep throat.
Deep throat.
They baited in. They basically met some folks in the administration and whatever, and they gave them this, that, and the other, and all of a sudden, they threw it out there. These guys wrote books, made millions off of this stuff.
Yeah. Tell your audience what you're referencing, Deep Throat.
Deep Throat.
Just so everybody knows what you're talking about.
Well, I'm thinking about the, well, let's see, I'm thinking about the, well, what am I thinking about? The insides. I mean, you have any idea?
Well, I mean, your Deep Throat was what
was
the source of the Nixon administration.
Yes.
Information was coming from.
Yes.
But it was a secret source.
Yes.
I think Vanity Fair broke the story, though.
Yeah. But still, it was deep throat.
Yeah.
But before that, it wasn't. You see what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
So this is the more progressive. Hacking is now. See?
Yeah.
You don't have to worry about this part. See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Now, all you have to do is take this thing right here and just sit back there forever. And if you get something, good. I got Donald Trump. Oh, my God. I got his medical record, the whole nine yards. This one guy got on TV today and said, hey, I'll give you $5 million if you can give me his medical record.
Oh, my God.
$5 million. And the other guy on the other side who's basically going for Clinton, he's talking about Trump in a negative way. But they just going back and forth. He's got billions. One guy's got billions. He's got billions. And I'm sitting up here, I don't have any billions. I just got this, and I'm looking at the two.
Trump looks healthy to me.
Yeah, so all I'm saying is that if you got a position on any one of these people, keep it.
Hmm.
But the key is that what are you going to do? And please ask yourself the question, Does she relate, or does he relate to the issues that are bothering you today in terms of your way of life? That means you got to read the material. You got one vote. You got one vote, and you won't have that vote if you don't register. And you can't register for all four or five.
Okay.
I mean, you can be a Republican and vote Democrat.
Oh, yeah.
You can be a Democrat and vote Republican. You can be independent and vote Republican. You can be like Bruce and watch to the last minute and say, who am I going to vote? Right now, I'm determining the winner based on my background.
Yeah, well, we'd like to see other voices in the debate, too.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's what I like. Yeah. Now, I tell you, the Libertarian Party and the Green, but I really like that Libertarian Party because you got two governors, seasoned governors. Now, why aren't they spending some time with those guys? Now, they did hit Gary the other day in regards to a place up in the ISIS where they're fighting up the war. You know, Gary's smiling or whatever. As far as I'm concerned, Gary should have jumped on the plane when Trump went to Mexico and said, hey, I want to know what's going on. Let's talk about this. Let's talk about this immigration piece.
Yeah.
I got a solution. I was governor of New Mexico and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That's what he should have done. The same thing with the lead issue. Now, Trump jumped on the lead deal today.
Oh, did he?
On the lead in Michigan. He went down there.
Oh, wow.
He went down there and met some black folks and went down there to the Water Bureau and looked at the water coming through the pipes.
Wow.
And then he spoke in the front of some people and then he started jumping on the campaign piece on Hillary. And then the minister that put the piece together, oh, wait a minute now, you're just supposed to talk about, just introduce yourself. We won't start talking about no politics. Oh, you know what he did? Yes, ma'am, I understand, Reverend, no problem. And he went back to his deal, nice and cordial, and he started shaking hands, and I saw one guy didn't want to shake his hand.
there's always somebody.
But he was talking to the black, but this was a white guy, one of the guys who was part of the administration didn't want to take his name because he was just talking. He was just saying, and you know what he did? He just cool. All right, I'm going. So we haven't seen the last of the whole piece. Now, I gave you that piece on that. Let's see, what did I say now? We talked about the age factor, and we talked about the fact that if they want to make some rules right now, the media can do this right now today. Both of them are hungry. Both want to win. Everybody want to. As far as I'm concerned, Gary should be the first one. He said, okay, fine, what I want to do, I propose that on the medical deal, all of us right now, we will sit together a committee of doctors, that they will all have to go through the physical right now, today. Right now, everybody go through the physical. Here's the committee, and the AMA, American Medical Association, will pick the doctors. Make sure you got a female in there, make sure you got every color in that piece.
Right.
And then they'll say, man, you come in there for your exam. And the taxes are simple. Hey, Mr. President, Congress, we want 10 years of their taxes. Release them. They got them already. In fact, they got them right now. They're waiting for somebody to say, I'll give you $5 million for the taxes. Somebody's going to come up with it because they're working right there in the IRS.
Yeah.
They do that all the time, right? Part of the party. So I think that's a way of doing it. Wouldn't you think? What do you think? That's a solution.
We better keep summarizing because we just have 3 or 4 minutes. So let's...
Let's see. Can you give us a little bit more about this Libertarian? What do you think about the Libertarian Party?
I'm...
Your thoughts.
A member of Western Liberty Network, which is what I'm representing right now. We're nonpartisan.
Mm-hmm.
I can give my opinion, but I'm not going to speak in support of any one candidate in particular.
But can you define it? Can you define it? What is the Libertarian Party?
The Libertarian Party, as I understand it, because I'm also a libertarian, is majorly concerned with the freedom of the individual, because it's the individual that makes up the community.
Okay.
The community is made up of a bunch of individuals.
Okay.
So the more power that an individual has over his or her own life, the more responsibility they're taking for their freedom, the better off the community is. So these are some of the principles that libertarians believe in and stand for.
Mm-hmm.
Gary Johnson, you can look up on his website, I'm sure, about all of his opinions about all of this. But that's the gist of what a libertarian is. Mm-hmm. A libertarian is a bit of taking some of the best ideas from the Republican Party and some of the best ideas from the Democratic Party.
Oh, okay.
And pushing them together.
Oh,
mm-hmm. Okay. Interesting. Yep. I like that.
So it's social liberalism. Okay. So that means assimilation.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Non-discrimination.
Okay. Cool. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. And some of the economic ideas that the Republicans are known for embracing. Mm-hmm. The economic ideas have to do with not redistributing wealth, okay?
Not redistributing.
Right.
What's your definition of that?
So what that means is if you're redistributing wealth, it's a lot of what Democrats are for, mm-hmm. okay? So what Democrats are saying, well, we want to make sure that you don't discriminate against black people or Hispanics, you people.
Well, why those two people?
All of them.
What about everybody? Okay. Maybe poor people.
Right. Poor. Well, I was using the color. The race is an issue.
Okay.
So we're going to make sure that you don't do that. So we're going to pass some laws like affirmative action.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of money involved in that. Okay. So it's like regulating people by taking money to make sure that you're going to behave properly. And we'll give it over here to this group.
Shouldn't have to do that.
You shouldn't have to do that. Well, it doesn't work for one thing.
Right, okay.
Okay, because it's not, you're going to change your attitude because it comes from within you, okay? Right. And also you're going to listen and want to be a person that cares. Right. You're going to want to assimilate because it's best for everybody. If you're strong and powerful, that's what you are.
So they're going to be strong in education, that with some of the things that we're talking
Absolutely.
About.
Absolutely.
Making sure that people are educated during those formative years. That's important?
Right. Right.
That's a very important piece. And, for instance, just like the immigration issue, what any thoughts, not putting you on the spot or whatever, but any thoughts about what Gary is, how does he feel about this whole immigration issue between Mexico and U.S.?
Well, he was on the border, I think.
Right, I thought maybe he would be really pushing that. Does he feel just as strong about the physical border?
Yeah, I don't know. We'd have to check with the campaign for issues.
It'd be good to see if I can get that. We can get that on the air.
Yeah.
It's very important.
Yeah, he better speak to those issues.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. But I mean, libertarians. Oh, go ahead. Are you?
No, I'm just saying.
About 2 minutes.
Like I say, there's just about a minute left, and we want to make sure we've thanked our crew for making this show possible. Of course, thank Portland Community Media.
Yes, right. Very much so. Very much so. It's really, and please, sometimes give, I don't know what city commissioner has the, basically the overseer of the community media aspect, but give them a call and thank them for, tell them how well you like the idea of this particular show, and, or if not that, just the community medium, the whole medium. Because these are really good people, and these are people that are just these are volunteers. You don't get paid for this situation.
No, we don't get paid. None of us.
None of us get paid. Yeah. We're just here sharing our thoughts, sharing our ideas.
Right.
Very independent. Freedom. Isn't that freedom? And we want you to do the same thing. And so tell your friends and whatever to turn us on.
Yeah.
I mean, it's unfortunate you can't get the rabbit ears anymore, but.
Yeah. And we want to thank you very much for watching this. This has been, I think it's been very informative.
Yes, thank you.
We've done
you like that?
A very good job.
Maybe ask Jim, too, by the way. He's running the controls out there.
That's right.
He didn't put it on auto. He was supposed to be coming down here and talk about this stuff.
I thought I was
going to
pay.
Oh, you just told him he's not.
He's not. Oh, I thought he was. I think we gave him a check. Oh, okay. I'll check that out. Next time around, we'll fix him up.
He says we're on another minute here.
Another minute? Oh, another minute?
40 seconds.
Okay, 40 seconds. Well, anyway, hey, check my show out Sunday.
That's right.
I'm going to have some
4
good stuff. I've got a guy named Art Robinson. Art Robinson is going to be on.
What
He's
going
against DeFazio. Channel 11. Channel 11 at 4 o'clock. Channel 11 at 4 o'clock Sunday. Please check us out. Awesome stuff. We're going to really get into some stuff. Maybe even talk about lottery. Got some folks going to be talking about some lottery. Where does the money go? Follow the money.
That's right.
It's supposed to be big time education, and we're short on money, if you will. But kids are still failing. Where's the money?